Well, thank you so much, Sascha, for joining me today. Super excited to chat with you about a lot of different endeavors that you've been on and now your journey into the space economy with bluShift Aerospace, and talk about how we can do space sustainably, right? And is that even possible? What are some of the first steps that we're seeing in making that happen? What's the current state of the space economy? What can we look forward to in the future? There's a lot of exciting things happen, but you know, sometimes it takes a while to get there. And we need like important teams like you guys to build this stuff effectively and sustainably for the rest of the world. But before we hop into bluShift, talk about your journey into space and into fuel, and how did you even get into the space economy in the first place?
Yeah, I mean, I mean, truly, I think the beginning comes from when I was a kid, right? So, like, I happen to be a child of the just post Apollo era. When I was a kid, it's when they were writing all the books about what they did in the Apollo era. And so you have all these expectations when you're a kid of what the future will hold when it comes to space and space exploration. And pretty much none of that was fulfilled during all of my childhood and well into my adulthood. So, but I mean, ultimately, you know, I grew up in Maine, where you can see the universe because it's there. There's the light pollution so low, and so I actually grew up in the woods of Maine for many years of my life, and
wow,
sort of developed that sort of wonder for the universe, but the appreciation and love for the planet, or, you know, the natural beauty of, in this case, Maine. So as I grew up, I my passion and love for space continued, and you know, I ultimately got a degree in physics and electrical engineering. But sort of ethically and morally, I always wanted to find a way to combine technology, but have making technology benefit humanity and our planet. So in 99, I actually started up with two other folks a renewable energy company, which is still in existence today and doing well, providing solar products and systems for people wanting to live off grid or wanting to be, you know, providing their own solar power into the grid. But my passion for space never went away. And it was probably in the mid, you know, end of 2012 that I decided that I want to just focus all of my excess time and energies into everything I could learn about rockets, propulsion systems in a way, and ultimately pushing humanity's ability to explore the universe further in some commercial fashion or some enterprise. So sure. Short of it is I started doing my own rocket engine tests with another engineering mate of mine from college many years ago. And then we were using petroleum fuel, and we were doing these engine tests on my brother's farm, these small engine tests. And it was just happen chance, really serendipity, that I happened to come across a certain substance on my brother's farm. He's an organic farm. And sitting down, it was after doing engine tests one day, sat down in his kitchen, and on his windowsill was something he'd just pulled off the farm like a week or two before. And I thought, man, what if that could work as a fuel? And if it could, and even doesn't work as well as petroleum, it'd be far more sustainable than petroleum. And, you know, this could be manufactured, the fuel could be manufactured basically anywhere in the world, but anywhere in the United States, there's farms. So it was like 2 weeks later, we spun up what we call a fuel core or a fuel grain, tried out the fuel. And not only did it work, it worked actually better than the petroleum fuel that we were using, which is like, for me, it was a slap in the face. Like, why has nobody done this before? And I think, it was from that point on for the next several years, the journey was that nobody could believe you could use something that wasn't derived from petroleum to power rockets, including right. NASA. When we applied for grants, there was a lot of pushback, and as comes with anything that's new and different, right?
Sure. Are you able to say like what it is, or like,
I can't tell exactly. I can't say what exactly. I can say that it's a solid fuel. It isn't manure, because people often ask us, is it manure? It's not manure. Like I was filmed on CNN. Actually, they asked me to eat the fuel, and I said, okay, I'll do it. And I did it on camera. You could eat it. It's not calorically really beneficial to humans, but it won't cause like severe gastric distress. I had no problems with my belly after I ate it, but it is a byproduct for a lot of farms. And it actually benefits by farming practices that are more sustainable, and organic farms especially. So it is a solid fuel. It's not a liquid fuel. And that kind of speaks to our engine. Our engine, it's something that's called a hybrid rocket engine. We ultimately developed that technology under a grant from NASA. But it basically, it hybrid just means that instead of having both your fuel and your oxidizer be liquids, we have our fuel as a solid and the oxidizer is a liquid. So it's a hybrid between solid and liquid fuels and
why
oxidizers.
Just really quickly, like, why focus on specifically rockets and not go into like other, I guess, or sell it in other sectors, right? Or like whether it's like tractors or obviously like cars or any type of form of mobility. What was just space the attraction for you because of, like, you know, just your love for it, and maybe the economics of that part of the economy is going to go up quite a bit, that you decided to go down that route? Because it seems like it could fuel other things too, correct?
Technically, you know, you could come up with systems that would allow like cars to, you'd have to kind of sort of reinvent not the wheel, but the motor, to allow it to work with our fuel. But with the source of our fuel, I think we have no issue with powering our rockets from now and definitely into the future as we get bigger and bigger and do more and more launches. But I don't know that the raw materials, at least currently, could sustain, like, for instance, a whole country powering their cars. It would be very much an overhaul of our agricultural systems, not necessarily in a negative way, but perhaps in a very positive way. But it would take a big reshaping of our how we do.
Sure,
it.
Sure.
Yeah. The short of it is, to answer your question, I think it's a sort of a niche market, right? Space transportation. Yep. We don't all do it, and it's a niche market within that sector. So we're doing very small, relatively small rockets, taking small payloads to space.
I wanted to talk about what bluShift is. So it's a good opportunity to go right into that. And what does bluShift do, right? You kind of stumbled upon this fuel, and now you're making rockets that are deployed to space for governments, for businesses. The point is to bring satellites. Is that the cargo that we're talking about here? Or I guess just walk us through what bluShift is and sort of that mission and vision.
Our sort of 5-year timeline is to ultimately be taking tiny satellites to space. And these are satellites called small satellites or nano satellites. And they're providing many of the same services that those big bus size satellites that cost billions of dollars provide. Communications, earth imaging allows us to track weather, allows us to track climate change. And these are what our customers are doing. They're the small satellite customers. And really, in the last 20 years, there's these small satellites have gone from something that students were doing in colleges and universities to full-fledged, many multi-million-dollar companies are doing to provide these services. And for instance, you know, some of the services are, you know, some of the images we see in the news today with the war in Ukraine and other places, or volcanoes off in the Pacific, those are being captured by these tiny, tiny satellites. And so there's a market of something like $30 billion expected for just launching these tiny satellites in orbit. And the fundamental problem these little satellites have, even though there's a big economy that's growing for them, the biggest problem they have is that their only way to get to space is to run sort of like second-class citizens on the gigantic rockets. Think SpaceX, ULA, United Launch Alliance. So these tiny satellites you and I could hold in our hands, having to ride next to satellites that are as big as a school bus.
Wow.
And so they get no priority. They don't get to go where they want to go. I think for me, that's sort of the best metaphor is you want to go to grandma's house and visit her for Christmas. And, but your only option is a freight train. So you'll take the freight train, because that'll cut down the first 400 miles of the travel to see grandma. But it's, you know, if that last couple of miles to get off that freight train, you're going to have to hoof it. And that's what happens to these small satellites, is they basically have to hoof it, as in they have to have their own little propulsion systems to kind of move themselves where they wanted to be in the first place. And that can take weeks or months to get there. And what we're going to provide is the ability for these small satellite customers to go, you know, have their own car, have their own taxi service, exactly where they want to go.
Gotcha.
So our rockets are small enough that it'll fit their size. Now, that's what we want to do, I would say, in the medium term. And in the short term, we're leaning in heavily to focus on supporting STEM. You know, I call it space STEM, S-STEM.
Yeah.
We're leaning, it's double S-STEM. And we're leaning really heavily on supporting not only students from K through, you know, college to do experiments in space, but students across the world. So for instance, already our very first customer base is through a company called Max IQ Space that create these sort of Lego-like science modules that students can design their own experiments, launch in our rocket, do actual space science, collect data and analyze it. And I've been really impressed by how invigorated and how inspired the students get to be part of this, to be doing this. Because we've already, believe it or not, we've already like started incorporating students in their these electronic experiments. Not only will be in our launches, but we've already incorporated into our rocket engine tests we've been doing the last couple of years. And so it's been really neat to see these students really get inspired and do actual real science.
Well, there's so much to do now. You can have a whole degree, I imagine, is going to be in the works for a lot of these universities, because there is a place to go after that, right? There's going to be so many jobs in the space economy that you're going to have. I'm sure there's like aerospace degrees, but there's probably could be like degrees in satellites and degrees in all kind of different things revolving around space.
Space operations, logistics.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be security. An enormous opportunity for students. Because like you said before, I think it was kind of like you said growing up, like you can look up and you can kind of wonder and be inspired, but there's not really much you could do. But now for that kid, you know, middle school or high school, you know, entering college, is like going to be opportunities. So it'll be much, much more easy to like touch out and feel, so to speak, of like what the opportunities are, what you could do within just the space arena, not necessarily go into space, right? Metaphor would be like sports. Like you don't have to play sports to be involved. There's the front office, right? There's the agency side. A lot of people can't play sports at a professional level. A lot of people aren't going to be able to go to space as like an astronaut or whatever it might be, but they can be involved in that entire economy and ecosystem.
And you've really seen this shape, you know, change its shape in the last 20 years. So it's gone from like anything to do with space is really the government domain to becoming into the private domain, you know, with SpaceX, Blue Origin, with Virgin, you know. But I'd also even argue like Copenhagen Suborbitals, which is sort of this volunteer group that's going to be sending humans up to space and back again. And that's really shaped over the last 20 years. And even with International Space Station, which is supposed to be decommissioned, you know, that possibly can go into private hands and become sort of a space hotel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But that's, you know, even for us as a small launch company, there are so many jobs available, you know, everything from the marketing side of things to, you know, we're ultimately going to be launching from off the coast of Maine on a sea-based platform, not just because we're in Maine, but just we actually have a geographical advantage that we'll be the very first company in the United States to, I think, the only privately held spaceport. They'll be able to launch into it's called polar orbit. It's a very specific orbit that goes around the North and South Poles, where we just launch right over the Atlantic Ocean and basically heading towards Antarctica, not going over anybody's houses or people or property, which is really key unless you're in China. And that's turns out that's the number one orbit for these tiny satellites. But to do all this, you know, we need people who are going to be, sure, we're going to need engineering. We're going to need folks who are going to help us do the manufacturing side of the rockets we'll be launching. But we also need people who are going to be interacting with customers, who are going to be, we really want to make it a real whole experience for our customers, because our customers, because of the type of customers they are, they will be coming with their experiments and ultimately their small satellites to the launch site. And they'll be coming to the state of Maine. And we really want to create a sort of a whole end-to-end experience. It's not just about launch. It's about the whole experience of coming to see your experiment or your initial satellites to launch into space for the very first time. And so we need everybody from HR to customer service to people who are really good with working with the public. So the whole everything in between. And a big part of who we are is transparent and sharing the science and experience to everybody, which is part of the reason why we share so much online, especially our YouTube videos. And we expect to continue that right up to the point where we'll be sharing virtual reality videos of the rocket launches.
How do we, and by we just as like a society and I mean a species, it's tough to obviously mandate certain things in other countries, but as like US space companies, like how do we get this right as far as being careful or being conscious of how this affects, I don't know if biodiversity in space is the right thing, but like a lot of how we've kind of not worried about our biodiversity and our atmosphere here, you know, just from a pollution standpoint, and saying, hey, let's keep growing the economy, keep growing. And now we sort of see maybe some of the side effects from that. How do we perhaps go into this a little bit more responsible as we're truly dealing with outer space? We absolutely need to take care of that, right? I mean, obviously the Earth is one thing, but is there a way we can do this responsibly as we move, you know, move to outer space in a way where, like you said, people could be staying at the space hotel, right? And eventually multi-planet species and stuff. Like, how do we start to do it right from the foundation? Because we are in the beginning, right? This is where you kind of set guidelines, rules, whether it's policies that governments, you know, state, or whether it's a collective part of startups and companies in the space. Like, how do we get it right? Looks like, look, we could start with fuel for some of this stuff, right? That, you know, carbon neutral fuel is a great way to go, right? Is there other things that is possible now or in the future where we do this in a responsible way?
We are constantly challenged internally, and I would say as an industry too, to how do you do things in a way that's minimizes the harm on the planet? Because basically when we're consuming things or manufacturing things, we there's always a cost, right?
Sure.
Which is how do you offset that cost, or how do you minimize it? And, you know, for instance, one of the things that I found early on was that, you know, even the batteries in a rocket can be a source of toxicity, right? So for instance, you know, the go-to for us would probably be like lithium type batteries. Well, it turns out maybe the lithium and the anode and the cathode are not toxic to the environment, but the electrolyte is. The goo that's kind of between the two. And that when those are
exposed. Well, then you have to mine the lithium in the beginning, right?
Right. Yeah. That's a very good point. And that has very, you know, very significant costs. So, you know, one of the things, you know, we're going to, you know, our rockets will be reusable, and our intention is to recover the rockets in entirety and reuse as much as we can from launch to launch. But on occasion, things will be lost and go to the bottom of the ocean. And you want to know that you aren't adding to the contamination, which humanity just kind of unloads into the ocean on a daily basis.
Yeah.
And for me, that, you know, it's kind of looking at everything, how you build a rocket. What, for instance, we inevitably will be using composites. Right. And resins that go into those composites off gas and are and not good off gassing, but tend to off gas for some time. And are there resins, and it appears to be there are resins that off gas less. And so you end up having to make sort of this decision of what's going to create the least harm to our planet, what's going to take, you know, least amount of resources to get those raw materials. And then you inevitably take some compromises in terms of performance. And the challenge in the aerospace world, well, not the aerospace, but I would have to say really the space world, is you are eking out every single half percentage point you can on performance. And so when you say, well, we'll use this resin, but we're going to have to cake it on a little thicker because it doesn't quite have the same strength qualities as the toxic stuff, you're making a sacrifice. You're going to have to make a rocket. It might be a little bit bigger, a little bit heavier, and carry a little less customer payload. But I think we have to be okay with that. And we have to be okay. Like, it shouldn't be that the Earth can take a hit at all to whatever venture I want to run. I have to be cognizant, or we have to be cognizant of what the sacrifice is and how the heck can we minimize it to achieve our aims as a enterprise. And I think that's something that, especially in the aerospace industry, has been absolutely ignored. And you look at some of the rocket launches, not necessarily in the US, but like in other countries, and you see these red plumes, and that's a toxic gas that's coming out. Mm-hmm. That anything downwind of that it's probably been devastating, including plants. Our industry is sort of rife with environment doesn't come last. It just doesn't come into play. And
it always takes a backseat to innovation, I feel like.
Complete backseat, not even the bumper sticker backseat, exterior of the car.
They built the trailer, and that's where they put it.
Whoops, that bounced off the back. Yeah.
When we talk about the cost of this, right? You kind of mentioned wanting to be able to reuse the rockets, because as a business model, right? I'm trying to find the sustainability within the business model, right? And it seems like you'd have to be able to reuse. Yes. Most of these rockets, right, to get to that point where it's a viable business model, you know, for this economy to really scale, because it all starts with the rockets, right? That part has to be, you know, economically viable to get the innovation in it.
Yeah, I think, you know, remember, the rocket industry kind of comes from the missile industry. Back when people thought, well, this thing's taking a one-way trip anyway, so I don't care. It's going to blow up, right? And just they reallocate.
That alone is amazing, right? That we can kind of get these things back now, which is...
Yeah, but I don't think it was all... I don't think it's as hard as our governments would have put out there. It was just additional engineering, right? Mm. And even in our case, our suborbital rockets was... which just means rockets that go up to space and come back down. I mean, that's pretty easy to recover. Yes, you have to, in our case, we have to go out to the ocean, and we'll be hiring out commercial fishermen to help us retrieve our rocket. But
because you'll be able to know where exactly it kind of is going to be.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. And maybe that's where the heritage is. Like early days, they didn't know exactly where. And then by the time they got to it, there's a good chance it would have sunk. But those are just engineering problems. Make it so it doesn't. And make it so you can, you know, more easily locate it. Being more sustainable is not only about, it's not only about reusability. It's not only about making decisions at the design and manufacturing levels on things that'll be less toxic for a planet, more sustainable in its production and raw resources. But it's also about literally, where do you get the energy from to produce fuel, to produce, in our case, it's effectively the sun. And we're, you know, to manufacture the rockets, you know, that we're at a previously a naval air station in Brunswick, Maine. And in the 10 years or so that since it's been decommissioned, there's now multi-megawatts of solar panels powering the bulk of our campus. We, even at our test site, our first launch system, and our future manufacturing site have been and will be powered by renewable energy, by solar power mostly. And these are all decisions that we can make. And I am not the first guy who happens to own both a solar company and a rocket company, but I apparently am the first guy that has both and has considered using and implemented and executed from the beginning, seeing renewable energy at every point that we can for everything we do.
It's quite a regenerative process, it seems like. Like the whole ecosystem can be pretty regenerative, it sounds like.
It can be.
Obviously, that stuff takes time and
resources and investment.
For sure.
Right. But if all you care about is the bottom financial dollar, you don't care about the larger humanity and planet Earth dollar, then you won't put solar panels at your launch site. You won't put solar panels at your rocket engine test site. You won't put it at your facilities. But we do.
We talked about a little bit earlier some of the things that is happening with small scale satellites right now, or even satellites in general. Can you talk about, I guess, because, you know, look, I'll speak for myself, but like a space layman, right? Like I know a little bit, but I don't know a ton at all. And part of why I like to have these conversations is I like to learn. So what, I guess you don't have to name the clients, right? But maybe if you can mention some of the things that are being done, right? Like a client comes to you or whoever comes to you and say, hey, we want to use your rockets to go do this. Like, what are some of these, let's call them startups or now, like startups doing with your rockets? Like, what are they going? Is it just pictures? Is it data analytics? It seems like there's going to be a lot of need for analytics, especially in the climate space. There's so many climate tech companies coming out trying to define and measure, you know, carbon sequestration, carbon offsetting, trying to validate these things. Is that a lot of the things that these satellites are doing, is really collecting data, taking pictures? I guess, what are some of the cool things that you see happening in just the space economy now?
Sure. Yeah. So like, you know, probably within our realm, like a company called Planet, we've had conversations with, that makes these satellites that are they're like shoebox size, maybe a boot block size. And these are, they have a whole constellation of these small satellites that they put up over the years. And that they, you know, they're replacing and adding to over the years. And these are satellites that are, they're providing optical images of the planet once a day in high resolution, but they're doing it also in multiple, you know, different wavelengths, visible and non-visible, and provide, you know, then they sell that data to different folks. It could be colleges and universities, could be nonprofits. My wife works for an environmental nonprofit organization. It's preserving the coastline of Maine.
Right.
And they use that type of data to kind of see where, you know, how the marshlands are changing and where, whether it's release or more or less release of methane gases and stuff like that. And you can understand the health of forests, but you could also understand the health of of farmlands and stuff like that.
It's like a CT scan for the earth.
That's one way to do it. Yeah. And so there's other companies are coming online doing the same type of thing. Another company we've been in communications with is a company called Spire, and they basically create these small, similar sort of form factor satellites, but they might have multiple sensors, multiple communication capabilities. And they're basically doing, instead of software as a service, they do satellite as a service.
Yeah.
So, you know, you kind of choose what realm of sensors and abilities you want to use, and you pay them for so many minutes or hours on the satellite to do what you want to do and how you want to do it. Maybe it's every time you go over, you know, the state of Montana, you want the satellite to be allocated to monitor grasslands or something like that, and it's being employed by a university there or something like that. So that's one. And then like another example is a company called Link, L-Y-N-K. And they are providing, again, these same sort of small satellites, but a whole constellation of them. And they will provide cell phone service. So instead of your cell phone tower being a couple miles off to your left or your right, it happens to be straight up. And really enabling you to use your cell phone if you're at the top of a mountain, stuck in the forest, or, you know, gotcha, in the middle of rush hour traffic in some urban setting.
Is that essentially how Starlink works?
Yeah.
Or have bigger satellites?
Yeah, exactly. So Starlinks are technically considered small satellites, but that's exactly what they are. There's a constellation of them up of there. But their satellites are quite humongous. You know, they're... Mm-hmm. I think each one is probably three times the weight that we would carry in our totality for our each rocket. But so they're very, very large ones. And I think, you know, the big change with these tiny satellites is that they, instead of kind of being put far away from Earth so that they last many years up in space, they can make them much smaller, much lower power, and much less expensive. But they put them in an orbit that's much closer to Earth. And the good thing from a sort of, we call it environment, we talk about biodiversity, we talk about, like, you know, not polluting space. There is concerns about having too many of these small satellites or satellites.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question. Like, at some point, do we have, like, overpopulation? And, like, is there a limit to, you know, eventually there might be limits to how many can go up a year or something. I don't know, right? Like, would that be, like, 100 years, though, 150 years before you get to that point?
I think we're going to start encountering those sort of limits in the next decade, if not less. And there's already friction. And then you have, you know, nation states deciding to blow up their own satellites and just show people they can do that. And then they create so much debris that's random.
Yeah, right.
They can possibly take out other people's satellites and wreak absolute havoc on things that we now depend upon, not just the United States, but the entire planet. So you get instances like that are intentional, let alone accidental. So, but that's actually one of the benefit of these tiny satellites is that a lot of them are being put into orbits that are very low, and so they inherently they burn up
in the atmosphere. Huh?
Yeah, they burn up in a couple of years, and the reason why that's acceptable is that satellite didn't cost much in the first place. And in 3 to 5 years, maybe the satellite that Link used to provide cell phone service to anybody on the planet, well, now they want to go from, I don't know, 5G to 6G or 7G, whatever the next technology will be. And they have to refresh the technology anyhow. They want to update it and give it more capacity. So it actually kind of works out where the cost is low for them compared to traditional satellites. It's not creating much in pollution because it just doesn't stick around for very long. And that's, you know, just kind of one of the many nuances in how things are changing with the satellite industry and the services they're providing and how they work. It's gone from monolithic, giant, billion-dollar assets being put into space to something that could literally cost tens of thousands of dollars being put into space.
Last couple of questions here. One would be just to piggyback off of what you had mentioned before, maybe limits, regulations, policies. Where are we at, like, right now? For it is a really cool benefit of like your company is that the barrier to entry for a startup is a bit easier because they can kind of piggyback off of your, I'm sure you have to have some type of license or some type of registration to launch rockets and satellites, right? Like, I don't know the world, right? But there has to be some, I'm sure, a rigorous, because I think you need licenses for drones, right? There's some regulation around just drones. So I imagine launching is quite rigorous as well.
Yeah, it certainly is. We have to, you know, basically the agency that we have to work with closely is the FAA. We've been, since our, you know, we had a prototype launch 2 years ago when we made history as the first company to commercially launch a rocket using a bio-derived fuel, let alone one of non-toxic. But we even back then for that low altitude launch, we had to work with the FAA. And now we've been working very closely because the probably a factor of 100 more complex and more rigorous what we have to go to launch these, you know, our full-size rockets all the way to space. And on top of that, we're not only getting permissions to launch our rocket, but we're getting permissions to have our future launch site, which means we have to do a whole environmental impact study as required by the FAA. And it is very expensive, but, you know, you did kind of allude to that, you know, by private companies doing this before, or doing things like this before, it makes it easy for those to come in. That is true. There is some truth to that, you know, so, you know, the SpaceX's, the Blue Origins of the world, having to work with the federal government, kind of push it forward. There have been some modifications to regulations that really takes the industry from viewing it as space is a domain of governments to the space is domain of humanity. We're all allowed to play and commercialize it or do it for research. So I give a lot of credit to the FAA in that it's been really great to work with them, and they're very much in favor of enabling humanity and commerce to exist and beyond our planet. And their biggest concern is just, we've got to watch out for the safety for humans. And so making regulations that are clearer and for both a launch site and for rockets, they've done a really good job at kind of bringing clarity. It's still really hard. I would just have to say that we have the one advantage that when it comes, for instance, to environmental impact, unlike almost any other rocket, we know that when our rocket launches, or if it perishes in the ocean, the environmental impact, other than the physical pollution that it is physically in the way of something, it's not contaminating the waters, it's not killing fish, it's not killing the ecosystem below, let alone, you know, encroaching upon people's livelihoods because some giant oil spill. And that's, I think, you know, even with SpaceX rockets, you know, the last stage of those rockets, that when they go into the ocean, they're gone. And it isn't like all of the petroleum has been burnt out of that engine. There is probably thousands of gallons left.
Really?
Sinks to the bottom. Yeah, because you always leave a little bit of fuel left because you don't know how much of fuel you're going to need exactly.
Right.
So yes, they bring back their first stage rockets, but it isn't like all stages come back. Gotcha. And there's a lot of residual petroleum that's just dumped into international waters, but we don't talk about that.
Is the U.S. leading, so it's a weird word because it's so different, but are we leading the way in sort of allowing private industry to innovate? You mentioned the Copenhagen group. I mean, obviously, I'm sure China is deep into this, but probably more from a governmental standpoint. Is there other countries doing really cool and interesting work?
Yeah, there are. You know, there's you know, probably within our industry, one of the biggest competitors is a small country that in some way reminds me of Maine, that's highly dependent on agriculture and tourism, a country called New Zealand. They have a company called Rocket Labs. It's been this very much, you know, sort of embraced the new space industry, as we call it, and they're doing very well. They have pretty reliable launches to space. They're doing it off the coast of New Zealand. They're about to do it off the coast of the United States. So they're one. And, you know, I think in the UK, we're seeing some launch companies come online now. There's even one that's creating sort of a bio-derived propane for their fuel. And there's a company in Australia that's developing a hybrid rocket engine. It doesn't use biofuel like ours does. It uses, I think, burned plastic or something like that. But so, yes, we're seeing more and more countries support their entrepreneurs in the space industry, but I do think that the United States does dominate in terms of innovation, and I think a fair amount of credit goes to NASA. Believe it or not, NASA in the last,
I think it feels like they found their right role.
Yeah, they're
not sort doing of like everything the themselves. They just kind of become capital allocators of the grants and funding and picking and kind of. But that maybe at the end of the day, that's all that should have been kind of their role these last dead years of space, so to speak, right? After it's, like you said, it's just kind of been just silent a little bit. Obviously, work still gets done, but it feels like they finally found a good role for what they can do and be beneficial at scale.
I think you're right. I think that happened in early 2000s. Maybe it was the late 90s, but I think it was early 2000s. But yeah, they've gone from like, we're the only ones to go to space to, let's see how we can enable this industry. Let's take
be the incubator.
Yeah. And you know, for us, it, you know, early on, a few years ago, when we developed an original technology around our engine to efficiently combust our biofuel, it was, you know, a lot of our developments and leaps forward were with nudges and help from a technical contact we had in Alabama at one of the NASA centers, NASA Marshall Space Flight Center. And I was just sort of beside myself about how helpful he was and just kind of encouraging us along. It's like, wow, you feel like you're doing something wrong that they're helping us, but that is their job. That is their job.
And it's, that's great. So,
yeah. And I don't think you probably don't see that type of stuff in China, for instance, or other countries or countries, you know, that have the heritage that we do, or let alone Russia, for instance.
Yeah. Right. Last question here, kind of a little bit about the future. You touched on a little bit earlier, but, you know, looking into the next 3 to 5 years, let's say, what does success look like for you?
Yeah. I mean, for us, it's clearly, you know, we're launching academic and professional research payloads up to space, not once a year, not twice a year, but within 3 years, you know, we're launching at least a dozen times a year. In 5 years, we're taking up our very first small satellites into orbit, and we are demonstrating that this can be done not only profitably, but done in a way that's more environmentally friendly than any other launch company is doing today. And we're, to be honest, we're also developing an economy within a state that's in this new space industry.
I was about to say, absolutely.
That this state is not known for. But I can tell you, whether it's Alabama or Florida or Texas, there was a point in time, the before and after, where they were not known to be in the aerospace industry, and then they are known to have that capability. I think of like Austin, Texas. Austin, Texas used to be a great town and still is. But it wasn't known for its great software and high tech industry. Right. And I think, you know, a decade or two ago, they made some real moves forward. And the same thing's happening. And now they're really one of the meccas for doing high tech. And here in the state of Maine, for instance, there's a lot of the big effort underfoot to there's a new organization called the Maine Space Corporation that's been developed to help grow this economy out in a very intentional way, taking the long approach. And part of their mandate is to do this in an environmentally friendly way that is possible. And I don't think you see that with many other states at this time, to have that sort of environmental mandate.
Do you think you'll have the launch site ready within 5 years, or would that environmental study take years to do and get registered, get verified?
If we can achieve our funding goals, you know, we're wrapping up an equity crowdfunding raise right now where
over $1 million, huh?
Yeah, over $1 million. And that's allowed us to do what we've done to, you know, in the last year. And it's been sort of amazing to have all these people investing in us and have sort of almost like a fan base helping, you know, cheering us along.
That's great. Yeah.
But we have to raise another 5 to 10 million in the next few months. And if we can, once we raise that amount, that will pay for the environmental study and all the efforts we have to have. And if we achieve those goals, I see no reason why within a year to 18 months, we wouldn't be able to launch off the coast of Maine, have the approval of the FAA, have an environmental impact study done, and sort of be breaking history as the very first company to launch all the way to space commercially, a rocket using a carbon neutral bio-derived fuel and doing it off the coast of Maine.
Pretty amazing stuff. Well, thank you so much for taking the time, Sascha.
Thank you. Awesome conversation.
Best of luck to you and the team for next couple of decades to come.
Thank you. Well, it was a pleasure and thank you. You know, I really appreciate it. It's a pleasure talking with you, and I really appreciate the opportunity to share with what we're doing here at bluShift.